Good evening all. So I think this is the last presentation of third day. Do we have any? I think not. This presentation, we are covering by three people. I'm talking quickly about the globalization, then Alex will talk about the Zanata, and then John Baptist will talk about the globalization. This one session which I'm planning for a long time, at least from 6 months I'm planning for this session, and I think this is the opportunity. So I will generally say that what is happening in this session. So this is the slide which I always like to say that when we say globalization, these things come into that. So it is IGN, then there is a localization, then there is a Zanata, and then FLTG. So FLTG stands for Language Testing Group. So that group does the test day, preparing your test cases, that kind of stuff. Then moving to this next. So here I want to say that if you see this image of the Federer, you see all are closely tied. So unless until you don't have freedom, you will not have a friendship. You have friends, then you can get together, develop some features. When you start with features, you can have it first. So it's like, I only want to say here is, it's all are closely tied together. If one is missing, it will affect other. Same way, on the same line, we started globalization, I think last April 2015, we started this activity, the group, it's the umbrella group. And why we started it? IGN group has some good, every group has some plus and minuses. And what we thought that by having this umbrella group, we'll try to solve those things. So if you see, IGN was good at proposing a changes for each release, having a development following the Federer development cycle, that was good happening. From LTNN perspective, the localization team. So localization team has a more contributors and more languages. There are many active people. So if you say IGN, it's like 10 people around that are active. From the localization, it's like 50 plus people active in each release. From testing part of it, now IGN and LTNN doing something. So testing group has a testing expertise that to create a test cases. And again, translation platform. Translation platform here is Zanata. So they are serving localization with more stats. So if you remind the MATLAB sessions regarding the stats, so Zanata is the place where you will get all the statistics that what is happening, which language is doing how. We try to create an umbrella group on the top of this and try to make it as a more strategic group from the language perspective. So if you want to do anything in Federer from the language side, what should we do? If we're planning something, then what each group should do. Every group is required what thing and how we can split those things. So that was the plan behind the globalization. And we did good, I will say. So these are the few snaps. I think there are many, but I just quickly found this code. So this is the one localization sprint in Albania, that's the first one. Second, we had a quick meetup in Devon in 2016. Then that is the third image is from FAD, which we had at Japan. And the fourth, that the many small photos is the sprint which we did recently. So like, things we did under the globalization is that, of course, the FAD was very successful, I will say, because in limited amount of, like couple of 3 days, we did so many things. We worked, we talked, we planned, we had fun. So we did so many things, and it actually went like a mini conference, you know, because there were so many people there. And that planning we used till F27. So still, if we want to do anything, I quickly say yes. Let's go through that list and see what is missing. Was planning to finish my talk at this moment, but I think since we are late, we did a test days. We got more contributors for test days because like we became a single group with more contributors. We had a regular meeting, more active discussions on the mailing list, more recognition for the team. I think this thing happened definitely. So if anyone say that, what happens, I will say recognition. When we started globalization, everyone in the federal came to, yes, globalization is there, globalization is there. So I think, of course, we all, I should thank everyone for this because of the doing the good work, and that is the thing. Then I will move to the next. Now here I want to explain you the big link concept. Do you aware about the, this is more from the systems thinking. So your system strength is not more than the strength of your weak link. That is what. So like say if you have say in your team you have say 10 people and but one is like, no, rather than the people perspective, I think the manufacturing process is a good example. So if you have manufacturing processes and one process is not doing output or machine is not doing good, it will affect the whole thing. Same way, we had faced some problem in the globalization. And for problem I will specifically which I observe is that localization team, though group is very big, but there was not any activity in the localization group. That is the first problem which I faced. So whenever we were used to have a globalization meeting, we were mostly working on the localization issues. That is what I observed. And most of the time, the globalization meeting was actually a localization meeting. Sprint, we started, it went well. So we did a 3 sprint for the transition. But right now, if you take an example, like the most of the organizers, so I was the one, Yona, Alex helped, John Baptist helped, and the many people helped. So right now, they are going to merit us. So gradually, we need more leaders for this, and it is not happening. And it's like once we have a one lead, other people start come to support them. So we need this one lead. Again, the second points come to the one first one. If we have a lead, he can take care of this kind of things. Unless until we do not give strength to alternate, it will not make Jiren boss now. So this is point which I want to make here, that we need some more strength in localization. Once we have healthy localization group, it will actually help us to achieve the objective which we try for globalization. And this is the point which I wanted to make today, and we can definitely have more discussion about this. So any question at this moment, or maybe we can take question at the end of session. So John Baptist is going to talk about the localization. So I think he will keep 10 minutes something we have for our discussions.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I think, yeah, we'll stop here, then we'll have more discussion. Okay, so over to Alex. Thank you.
So for Zenata itself, let me close that. Knowing the multiplication. So for Zenata itself, I'll be mainly concentrating on the automations and a quick demo and a bit of basic statistics that I managed to get from the database recently for the past 6 months. So one of the main problems that we identified in with the Zenata platforms and the source repository was about the manual process that's involved in the whole workflow. So in the current process, there's a lot of manual work needs to be done by pushing up in the source to Zenata and followed by notification to the translators, get them to translate it in Zenata, then the package maintainer will need to pull translation from Zenata and push it back into the repository, then the build continues from there. And those manual processes usually based around batch or cell scripts or any script on cron jobs and using Zenata CLI because that's the client that we have. Another problem would be the installation of Zenata CLI because on the Fedora community, the Python client is preferred over the rest of the client, whereas Zenata CLI was developed on Java client, on Java languages, although we got a good wrapper around it so that it can be installed in Fedora, it's still a problem. And usually when it happens, package maintainer usually does the push and pull only a couple of months at a time, and by the time next time they want to do it, they need to update the client itself, and they just forget every command in there already, so by then, so that's the main problem. And another downside would be, yes, there will be requirements for basic command line knowledge in order to use another CLI method. So what we did was, initially we know the problems, then we were trying to develop an application to do the automations. The first time we tried was develop everything from scratch. So we developed new applications, web applications that handles all these things. But as soon as we rolled out the first version, we found out that there's a lot of problems that's already been solved in a couple of the CI's application available in the market. That's why we moved to Jenkins, because Jenkins is obviously a widely used and recognized CI in the DevOps space. And it has already a couple of plugins that we are trying to solve. So it's already integrated well with the Git repository. It's integrated well with, well, it has a strong feature of the scheduler. It has notification plugins that we are trying to solve at the same time. Repository integration, that's what I talked about. And security module. So all those problems that we face on our first option when we develop the application is already solved in Jenkins. So that's why we move up to, instead of creating a new application, we just create a plugins and on top of Jenkins. And the good thing about that is, yes, we can piggyback all those features that's already developed and well-maintained in the Jenkins community itself. And the last point, yes, we use features from Jenkins. So there's a lot of features in Jenkins. So these are the basic stuff that we were trying to target on our first option when we tried to develop the automations. Obviously, yes, there's a lot more in Jenkins that we can use, like integration with IRC, integration with a couple of systems that you can think of. So everything is there. The downside of using plugins instead of our applications is that obviously you require a Jenkins server to be up and running. Also, we are restricted with the Jenkins plugin development process. So if you are aware, Jenkins plugin, we need to follow certain workflow and certain criteria if you want to develop a plugin that's available for public community in Jenkins. So that's one of the limitations that we have. We need to work around with. Also, the problem would be access permission to both another repository. So if you want to use the well, with the plugin itself, we will need to input the credentials of the source repository as well as credential from Xenana server into the Jenkins. But like I said, Jenkins already got a good security modules in there, so I don't think it's a big problem, and a lot of the big communities is doing that as well. Everything is in one place. And also the plugin is limited to Jenkins server environment. Back to the first, ties up to the first point where, yes, you require a server to Jenkins server to run up and running. So that's the downside of having the well, developing the whole thing based on Jenkins. So that's the base diagram that I can put up. So on the left side, you've got all the stakeholders. Well, on the top, yes, the package maintainer or the writer, which is another spot as well, push and pull into GitHub, which is their source repository. Then on the Xenana side, again on the lower side, left lower corner, is the translator push or translate in Xenana. And those two entities on the left side will communicate to each other by the Jenkins plus the Jenkins plugin. So with the Jenkins plugin, every time the GitHub or every time the source files has been updated in their Git repository, it will fire up a webhook, and from the Jenkins, you will actually listen to the webhook. From there, you will push the updated source into Xenana straight away, or depending on how you configure it. And likewise, whenever a translation has been updated to Xenana, And again, depending on the webhook that you configure in Zenata, you would be able to push or send a signal to Jenkins, and the Jenkins plugin will be able to pull the latest translation and push back into Git, into the Git repository itself. So that whole process, you don't even need to install Zenata CLI. There's no manual process in there. You just need to configure it in the first place, and everything will just run automatically every time something updated, or depending on how you schedule it. So yes, there's no need of installing Zenata CLI. There's no need of push and pull manually from command line. You're just depending on the Jenkins itself to listen and push, do all the process into both of the entities. So for demo, let me do a quick one there. So in here, I got a Docker Jenkins running on my local machine. This is the Zenata plugin, which is published. So basically, if you're familiar with Jenkins, if you just go to manage Jenkins, install the plugin itself, and from there, you just need to create a job. So this is the job that I created. So what happened right now is, so this job is configured with this Git repository, and it's a proxy file type where this is the Zenata that I run locally, and this is the webhook that I configured based on the Jenkins itself. So based on the plugin. So every time you create, let me do a quick. Yes, new items. So just show you all the fields that's available in the plugins. So obviously the source code management, all this is that are the source repository modules or plugins that you can configure. So for Git, yes, configure it to point it to the GitHub. Is what I put in here. Actually, I should show this one here. It's easier. It has all the information. So here, so them. So yeah, the URL, this is provided by the plugin itself. So what you need to do is you need to copy the URL of the web URL, put it into Zenata projects, which is this one. So what happens is that with the webhook, when you put in the URL, you can configure what type of webhook that you want to fire up or send the signals to Jenkins when anything happens. So there's a couple of them that are related to translations, 100% translated documents, as well as whenever a translation updated, so edit every individual string. Also, there's a manual event where you just trigger it manually by the maintainer itself. If you don't want to be automated, you just need the maintainer to go in every weekly or something just to hit on the button in Zenata, then it will send a signal to Jenkins and start doing jobs. So this is how it's being configured. Go down to the bottom. Obviously, there's a credentials in here which is handled by the Jenkins plugin, security modules. And moving down, this is the part where you put in your Zenata credentials. So if you're familiar with Zenata, you'll be able to see. Let me know. By the way, this is another 4.0, so 4.3.0. So it's not being deployed to the Fedora instance. So with the Zenata credentials, obviously you need your APIs and your username in here, which is included in here. Then you get to select whether you want to push the Zenata or pull from Zenata and commit it to the Git repository on the way back. So that's the base general configurations that you need to do. Also, obviously the branch that you want to push to. So obviously with localizations, what happened in Red Hat is they always push to a localization branch instead of master branch, because obviously they want to keep master as clean as possible. And after reviewing the localization branch, then they will merge it into master branch. So right now with the demo, I just push it to master so we can see the date update and everything straight away. But yes, you can select whatever branch that you want to push into. So in here, what I can do is, now because I'm running on localhost, I won't be able to get GitHub to talk to my Jenkins, but I can do get my Sonata to talk to my Jenkins because we're both running on the same instance localhost. So what I can do here, let me refresh this. So right now, yes, it's 11 days ago and 6 hours ago and 11 days ago. So what I can do here. So right now the webhook is being configured so that it sends a signal on every translation being updated. So if I change one of this, hopefully it works, fingers crossed. Let's wait for a while. there you go, you can see it starts running. Then yes, so after that, if I refresh this, 12 seconds ago. And if I open this, I would have the latest update of Hello 1. So all this is automated. So again, from the source point of view, I can't demo it right now because I'm running everything on localhost. But if there's any commits up to the Git repository itself, if the webhook is configured properly, it should do the same thing. Send a signal to the Jenkins, and the Jenkins would actually push the updated source into the Sonata straight away. Yes, yes. So in the Jenkins, in the job itself, you can configure it only to do one job.
Okay.
So it's very configurable, it's very dynamic, so you can do whatever. Or you can mix and match whatever you want to do. You can even set it so that it runs based on cron jobs instead of waiting for the webhook from GitHub itself or from Sonata. So let me that's the options. Fine. Now those two tick boxes, yeah, push to Sonata or pull from Sonata. So yeah, it can be configured according to whatever the maintainer wants. Some of the project, probably you don't want the source to be updated to Sonata that often, and you just want the latest translation every day, then yes, it's Jenkins, you can configure whatever you want. It's pretty powerful. So that's for the demo. Let me bring back my slides. Yeah, so the last one is about the statistics that I managed to pull up. I thought it would be very interesting to see what's been happening for the past 6 months. So yeah, this first graph is about, it's all the languages, so not a particular language, so it's all languages. That's the activities that's been happening in the Fedora instance. So January, or obviously February, we've got a spike in there. March, I believe April was the sprint.
Is it 2017, right?
Yeah, 2017. April was the sprint, translation sprint, right?
The previous.
Yeah, so it's considered high compared to the rest of it, but somehow, yeah, February and March, we got a higher number on that. I can show you the more detailed one, the breakdown of what's happening on February and March.
So, this is for which branch?
Sorry?
Which branch of Fedora? This is generic, right? Okay, sorry.
General. All the projects in the Fedora instance. So it's
February, there was branch Fedora 26 from Rawhide.
Yes, so probably that's why. Because every time you branch it off, you would copy the translations
right
over and create a new one. That's why there's a spike there. Yeah? So that explains it.
it made me very excited that why there is so translation in February.
But it's a good, right? So
it's
so this is a breakdown of the top 20 languages that's been in, translated for the past 6 months. Japanese got the highest ones again. They got Spanish, and followed by FI. I'm not sure what language is that.
Finnish.
Yeah, okay.
It means you finish now.
Yeah, finish. then French, yeah, probably all of it. So this is just a basic stats. Obviously, I got the detailed breakdown if you guys are interested in for each of the languages. But yet,
can you export it on a regular basis, like once a month, or get more data,
let me think. We've got a couple of APIs that's in 4.0, so we'll probably be able to mix, combine those APIs, do a different couple of API calls, and probably we can get data from there. Right now, all this is doing by manual database query, because obviously there's some limitation on the drawings at the moment. But yeah, we probably can do it, we can automate it once the 4.0, or even before that, if I can run it locally, then yes, I can mix and match those APIs and automate the process of getting those data out. But yeah, that's about that. For the automations, obviously it's more targeted to package maintainer. And for translator, yeah, if you guys want to make use of the Jenkins plugin to automate the process, yes, I'm more than happy to help out with if you guys have got problems, so to set it up and everything. I actually talked to the infra team if you can use their Jenkins instance to host all these things. Obviously, they're more secure and stuff, so perhaps, yes, it's a possibility that we can use their Jenkins to do that. Yes, Brian?
I apologize for having walked in late, so I apologize.
That's all right.
Not specific. If this is to run Jenkins jobs to fire when Synology translations are updated, we should be able to host this within the CentOS CI infrastructure as part of a cooperation we have with CentOS.
Yeah.
So we don't necessarily need to talk to everybody.
Okay.
So
yeah, that's
when we're shifting a lot of those jobs over, so that between the two projects we'll collaborate on a single CI instance to make life a whole lot easier.
All right, okay.
And that's
cool.
Ready to listen to both webhooks and fed message on it.
All right, it's good to know. So yeah, we might have a solution there. So yeah, the only concern was there'll be a lot of credentials that we're storing in the Jenkins instance. That's why we chose not to host it ourselves, because we'll require those credentials from the package maintainer and the Zenata user. So it's best to host it somewhere that the infra team or someone that's more secure environments compared to us. But yeah, I'll pass it over to Jean-Baptiste.
He joins. So, Alex, there was some discussion to have a Zenata client for mobile as well, right?
For mobile?
Yeah. Was there any discussion?
Well, initially we were trying to do it in Android, but the problem was we figured out there'll be a lot of maintenance happening, because once you got Android, then you need to maintain it in the Apple one as well.
Okay.
So what we're trying to focus right now is to, instead of creating a client, enable the browser itself to support client or different resolutions.
Excellent.
So you can work on tablets or mobile. So that's what we've been trying to do in the editor itself.
So thing is that Fedora contributed a lot into the GSOC kind of stuff.
Sorry, again?
Fedora contributed to GSOC and that is one woman's program, right? Outreach program is there. So if you prepare a proper proposal for this, you can get some contributions as well.
For the Android apps?
Yeah, not Android apps, the
website?
Dynamic web, which is it.
Well, that one we already included in our design, so currently we are working on it. Yeah, but yeah, if we can get any help, then it's more than welcome to.
Starting with you.
Five.
wrong in my screen here, but it looks all right in that screen.
It's already started on another screen.
I need to close it first.
Yeah, it's there on third, yeah.
Okay. Hello everybody. So let's speak about localization. My name is Jean-Baptiste. I'm French translator and team coordinator. The slides are already online and you can access it if you want. So what do we do in localization? We want to improve the user experience and the federal operating system by translating application and every document that is related and useful to the end user. So there is no limit in what we translate. We do not translate any software that is 100% for federal. We translate whatever that can be used on federal. Most of the translators that are in our teams are also involved in LibreOffice, in Mozilla, in GNOME. We are a trans project. And the only limit is the translator will and the availability. And availability means our time, but it also means that there is the tooling to translate. So, are we currently addressing our actual users? The main difficulty with Fedora is we have almost no stacks. The only one I could get is from the Get Fedora website. And what teaches us is there's way more connection from India than from the United States. And in India, there is at least 20 official languages plus maybe 200 languages that are mother tongue or native languages. So we probably do not cover most of the language of the people connecting to the website. So this is data only for the third semester of 2017. It's not accurate, it's only using IP address, it's only using number of hits. There's one third of the hits you cannot link it to some country, but it's the only data that we have. We have no statistics about what is the language and operating system. So if any of you may have an idea about a source to guess about what are the language that our users are speaking, I would love to know it. So, to have success, we have to measure it. And I've been looking for a way to measure what we are doing. So, the first one is what the users see. We have GNOME software using app data. As you can see here, it's translated in French, and we can translate it over in every application. So, on the left, you see some the top 15 locale by package translation in Fedora 24. This means I take every locale available in Fedora, I take the locales that have the most important number of package that has translation, and then I make a top 10, and I take what is the average translation level of each package. What we learn from Fedora 24, which was 1 year ago, to Fedora 26, actually, we globally move slightly 1% more. So little by little, the biggest team can have hope to improve. But if you go deeper in the statistics, you will see that most of the teams are tiny teams. They have no hope at all to give a good user experience in app data for the end user in GNOME software. And this is on top, this is the difficult part of translation, because we are talking about the translation about the application itself, and some of them can be quite fast in terms of quantity to translate. And on the bottom line, you see the description, just the two lines that are describing the software. And if I am French, I don't know English, I type in French when I search, so if the description is not in French, there will be no match. So if you take the best teams, so again, there is the sort is the 15 locale that has the most description translated. the best game don't reach even 20% of the translation of the single description in the application. So the user experience cannot be really good when you don't speak English on Fedora, but any other language distribution. So all of these data will be from upstream. They are consolidated in a global file that we may translate. The question is, if we do something downstream in the Fedora world, it means you have to find a very easy way to push it upstream. If not, it's something that it's something that will be denied by the Fedora community. So if someone wants to go into this and find a way maybe to translate easily here on the aggregated level in Fedora and find a way to push it upstream or at least send a message with, we translated this, you can reuse it. Maybe with the tool you introduced a few minutes ago, I would love to discuss it and go to dive the subject because I think there's really something great we can do. So, I don't know what that slide is. Can we go deeper? Because what we have here is only app data files. There is app data files for some software, but not for every software. What we have to look for is the packages itself. When you use DNF, there's a command line that enables to create files inside the packages. So you can do some sort of query to say DNF, please tell me all the packages that put at least one file in my local directory for the French language. And this brings me 293 packages. Maybe with this, we can try for every language to know how many packages at least push one file here, and maybe we can have a trend over the different release of Fedora to see does it improve. And as a bonus, we should also be able to take the file and populate the database and maybe run some queries on top of it. And we should also be able to go and see the ambassadors and tell them, oh, you want to reach that country or that kind of community? How good are we or how bad are we? Do we support phones? We can answer this. Does it support the typing? We can answer this. Does it support translation? We do not. We just don't know. We have no answer for this. So this is another hint maybe that we can follow. If someone has some knowledge in DNF, I would love to discuss with them. So let's speak about coordination. This is what we have now. So you can drive with this car, but the problem is it's not this car. The problem is the way we are currently following. The way we are currently following is this one. So this is Transfăgărașan, which is a very, very nice road in Romania, which I will go someday, but yes.
That's awesome.
So this is really something that exists, and it's a perfect idea of the open source world. The way is difficult. At the end, you are on the top of the mountain, and you are very happy because you are not alone to reach that goal. And you are all together on this road. The problem is, with that car, is we have a very good engine. Nobody will tell you that Zanata is not good for translation. Zanata is very good for translation. The problem is, there is no feedback to the cockpit, like user activity, project updates. Alex talked about the new features that are coming, but yet at the moment, we just don't have it. There is no colors. Our communication is quite bad. If you go to our wiki page, I tried to change it last year, but it was just too much work. I did what I could, but we need to do way better. We need to improve and to promote the good people who are having some nice initiative, and we need to communicate about it. And when we do a sprint, we should be able to produce an article 2 weeks after the sprint to
to say we were 50 people and this is what we done. After we have some way to move around between us, it's the mailing list, it works, sometimes it's good, sometimes it's opaque, you don't see anything. We have an onboarding process which is very difficult. You have to introduce yourself to many places, you have to require some technical access to some obscure fast group, which totally makes sense from an infrastructure point of view, but for an end user, it doesn't. It's very complicated. Reaching the federal project and contributing for translators, it is difficult. Do we have toolbox in our I don't know the name in English? Do we have toolbox? If we have an issue with our car, do we know how to fix it? If we are meeting someone with his car having some issue, hey, I'm a little project, I would like to translate my documentation, how do I do? Hey, find a good guy. Because we have no toolbox to help. Do we create a good project? I think there's 150 projects in fedora.zanata.org, and I think there's more than 1,000 in translate.zanata.org. Do we know what those projects are, and do we have some important content that are missing that we want to take? We say, you are a good project, I want to take you, Fedora Developer Portal, come here, I want to translate you. We do not. And do we have some room for friends? If a project comes and say, help me, I want to join your project, is there a way to reach it? I see the camera connection, the slide, it's okay. Okay, and the last question, where is the driver? There is no driver. I heard that before I start translation, there were Noriko doing some great job. Maybe there were some other people before it. But since 2 years, we have a bunch of people, exactly what Pravin said a few minutes ago, who are just doing their best, but it's best effort. It's one third of the little hour we have to contribute each week or each night, or maybe just from 5 to 6 in the morning because you cannot sleep anymore, and you really need a driver. So, this is the present. Now you're gonna see the future. So this is the future. It has colors, so it means we will try to improve our communications. We should be able to see what's happening inside the machine because we have some windows, we have plenty of stuff, and we should have some cockpit to drive the car. Maybe we should have some tools, some quality tools. We have a great example a few minutes ago. Maybe we should be able to communicate and to reward the people that does good things for the translation. When there is a guy from Czech Republic who is doing a book for the newcomers and say, this is the way to translate it and please use it in your countries, we should have something to say, thank you, because you are following the good path. And this is something we don't do now. Maybe we should have more promotion for the mailing list. I have a statistic about the mailing list language, but it's so low, it's just not uninteresting. Maybe we should have multiple doors to reach the project. Why do we have to have so many steps? Is there some things that contributors can do without having so many obstacles in the way? Shouldn't we control the project getting in and out of Zanata? Not controlling like when you're not in the democracy, but controlling that just welcoming, communicating, we are welcoming a new project. I think the last point is that in the future, are we good enough to have an autonomous car, or do we still need a driver? So these are my point of view of the localization coordination objective, and I totally agree with what Pravin wrote a few minutes ago. And this is the end of my presentation. I would like to discuss it with you now.
We are open for question and answer.
So, you share the point of view.